Dr. Ordway's office. No, he isn't in yet. I don't know when. Will you talk to his assistant, Dr. Shaw? Dr. Ordway's office. No, sir. Oh, yes, Professor. I'll connect you with Miss White.
Miss White speaking. Yes, Professor Jennings. Your psychology class next Thursday afternoon. Yes, I'll remind him. Goodbye. Did you wish to see someone?
Dr. Ordway. What on earth are you dressed up for?
My dear Miss White, for 5 years now, I've been promising myself a vacation, but you and that infernal book of yours have always managed to upset my plans. This time, nothing is going to upset them.
But how can you go away when your time is booked solid with appointments and lectures for the next 4 weeks?
I'll show you.
Yes, Doctor?
Come in a minute, Shaw, will you?
Yes, sir.
Now I've seen everything. Are you about to psychoanalyze a trap shooter?
No. I'm about to leave on my vacation.
Oh, but you can't do that. Inspector Manning is counting on you to give an insanity test to that young matricide. I had him on the phone just now.
And you promised Professor Jennings you'd address the psychology class Thursday afternoon.
Mm-hmm. Well, Dr. Shaw will keep all my appointments. There you are. The place is all yours.
But where will you be? Suppose we want to get in touch with you.
Well, if that happens, you'd better consult a clairvoyant. Goodbye.
Polite to stare at folks. Come on.
You wanted some taters.
Oh, yeah. Give me £5.
It's your move, Ward.
Huh? Oh. So it is, Squire, but I can't seem to get going this morning. My head keeps a buzzing like a swarm of bees.
You got hot flashes, Ward.
What do you think, Hank? Maybe he's got a tetanus summer complaint.
Could be. I heard Goldie Showalter and Sime Weldy are down with it.
You ought to get you a bottle of Dr. Sam's complaint bitters.
Yeah. Oh, I reckon I'll close up my shop and go home. I'm getting a misery in my stomach.
Sit down and check on me, Luke. You ain't got no sheriffing to do.
Okay. Did you want anything else, Edie?
No, that's all.
All right, put it on the book.
Thanks.
Well, I reckon you're next, mister.
Are you Jeremiah Dobbs?
Yep, that's me.
I'm Robert Ordway from New York.
Oh, yes. You're the fellow what writ me a while back, wanting me to fix you up with some hunting and fishing.
That's right.
Well, you're too early for the hunting. Season don't begin for about another month yet.
Oh. Well, that'll give me some time to do a little fishing first.
Yeah. I reckon Judd Rookstool can take you to the best trout streams there is.
Judd Rookstool?
Well, you writ you wanted a guide, didn't you?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Well, Judd's about the best woodsman there is in the whole state. Hey, Judd, come here.
You'll have to do better than that, Sheriff. You want me to watch you.
This is Mr. Ordway from New York, the man what's hiring you to guide his hunting.
Howdy.
Glad to meet you, Judd.
Now, you can take him over to Doc Sam's. I fixed it up with him. He'd give him bed and board while he's here.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, thanks very much, Mr. Dobbs. I'll be back later to buy my trout flies.
I'll fix you up.
If you're looking for the kind of trout flies that'll catch them whoppers, you better drop into my drugstore next door. I got the biggest line in the township.
Maybe you got the biggest line, but I ain't saying your flies is any better than
mine. They are so better. Whose flies catched the prize trout last year? Yours or mine?
You're getting my dander up, Hank Nixon.
Well, I'll be back later, and I'll see you both anyway.
Yeah. Now, look here, Hank. You got no right coming in my store talking business to my customers.
Who was selling anything to anybody? I was just watching the checker game over there.
How's the hunting around here?
Well, you might get a deer off the South Ridge. Then again, you mightn't. All depends on how smart you are with a rifle.
I'm only a fair shot. I'm out of practice. Oh, I came mainly for fun and get away from my work.
I like folks that don't pretend to be what they ain't. Too bad you couldn't come a little later, though, account of this run of summer complaint we've been having.
Summer complaint? What's that?
Don't exactly know, except that some folks die of it real quick, like. Morning, Emmy. This here's Miss Ordway. He's going to bed and board a spell with you, according to Jeremiah Dobbs.
Morning, Miss Ordway.
How do you do, Mrs. Millicent?
Come on in. Make yourself at home.
Thank you.
I'll get you things.
All right, Judge.
Spare room is right over here. What city folks you sleeping in, but it's clean. There's a new mattress on the bed.
Oh, I think it's grand. I do appreciate your taking me in.
Do unto others, the good book says. Now,
Emmy,
I...
come here, quick.
Land sakes. What happened to Eve?
He got shot.
Just one of them accidents. Doc Sam home?
No, but he should be here any moment. He was over at Hawkins, treating Lindy Sue for summer complaint. Will you hurry him home, Mose?
Yes, ma'am.
Bring Eve into Pa's office. I'll tend to him till Pa gets here. Put him over there, Judd. How'd you get shot, Eve?
I was carrying a deer on my back. Somebody took a shot at it.
I thought the hunting season hadn't opened yet.
Kids must have got their dates mixed.
Here, lie down, son.
You know who shot you, Eve?
No, it come from far off.
You're lucky, son. The bullet just grazed your skin. Say, Judd, will you get my first aid kit? It's out in the car. And will you get me some sterilized dressing and some antiseptic, please?
Wait, I reckon you better not touch him till Paul gets here. He mightn't like it.
Oh, don't you worry. I've treated lots of wounds.
Eve is right here in your office, Doc.
What's been going on here, Emmy?
I've been awaiting.
Yeah. That's a right bad wound you got, Eve. You've been awaiting for what, Emmy?
For you to meet this outsider, Mr. Ordway, who's to bed and board here for a spell.
Howdy.
He started to take care of Eve, but I told him he'd better wait for you.
Here's a kid, Mr. Ordway.
Thanks.
Nice of you offering to help, but I reckon we can take good care of Eve ourselves.
Ain't gonna do any harm, let him help, is it? You might learn something new.
Learn something new, you say? That's what them county clinic doctors keep harping about. But I don't cotton to them highfalutin ideas. Get me a basin of water and some rags, Emmy.
Yes, Pa.
Now fix me a poultice of hickory ashes and black pepper.
Yes, Pa.
Aren't you going to sterilize the wound?
Don't need to. The pepper will draw out the inflammation, and the ashes will soak up the poison. Back here in the office, Matilda. Well, what's the matter? You look scared.
I am. Ward's terrible sick, and he swooned, and my sister Belle and I can't bring him to, nohow. Has he had any fever and chills?
One minute he was hot and the next a freezing.
Uh-huh. Just as I suspected. Summer complaint.
Will you come over and help him?
I hadn't thought of Matilda after him sneaking over at the county clinic for his doctor.
Please come. I'm afraid he's sick enough to die.
Get me a bottle of my complaint bitters, Emmy.
Yes, Pop.
Now, there. Don't take on. I'm going to help Warren.
Thank you.
You can tend to eat. The complaint's more important than the wound.
What does your husband think causes this sickness you call summer complaint?
Pa says it's the edibles and the violent hot weather.
Oh, well, have they ever made a bacteriological test of the drinking water or the milk around here?
A what?
A microscopic test which shows if germs have made the water or milk unfit to drink.
Oh, I never heard of anything like that.
Well, that's all right. Never mind.
You reckon I ought to mosey along, or you want me to wait for you?
You wait, Judd. I'll only be a few minutes.
But Pa said I was to tend to Abe.
You're going to. Only I'm going to show you how they treat wounds back in New York.
Mighty pretty gal, Belle, you know it.
Do you think so?
Sometimes I wish you wasn't my sister-in-law.
Howdy, Belle. How's the sick man?
He's come to a little.
Yeah, appears that way. Get me a big spoon.
Yes, sir.
Is he all right?
He will be when I get some bitters down him. Now, Matilda, don't be so fluttery. Ward?
Hmm? Oh, hello, Doc Sam.
Open your mouth. I'll give you a dose of medicine.
Oh, Doc, you do give such awful taste and stuff.
You want to get well, don't you?
Pa. Here's your miniatures in the kitchen. Wants to know if you want another jug of corn squeezings.
Tell him to leave a jug and I'll write him down for some barber work.
All right, Pa. Pa said leave another jug and take it out and barber him.
Okay. You think your Ma would mind if I took a look at Ward and wished him well?
Nah, come on.
You keep on taking the bitters every 2 hours. I'll be back again tonight.
Hello, Doc Sam.
Hello, Izzy.
Pa, Izzy wants to wish you well.
Well, I swan. When I heard you was down with a complaint, I was expecting to find you sick on the dime. But you ain't sick at all.
I don't feel so good.
Well, don't let it worry you none. You'll be fit as a fiddle by the first of the week and ready to shingle my hair.
Oh, your bangs do need a trimming. Fetch me my shears, Belle. Kneel down, Ezri.
Here you are, Ward. I'll be back to keep you company in a little spell.
See that you do. Stoop over. I just can't seem to do it, Ezri.
Oh, that's all right. It can wait.
Tarnation's going on here.
Maybe them state policemen are dropping in to tell you how to do your lawn.
What's the idea?
You can read, can't you? All right, fellows, across the street.
What's all this?
Look, for those of you who can't read, this sign means that the county health officer is putting the whole village of Brook Falls under quarantine.
All this rumors just because a few folks have got a touch of some complaint.
Maybe that's what you call it, but it's actually typhoid fever, and nobody's going to leave this village without permission from Dr. Wickersham.
Where'll I find Dr. Wickersham?
He's standing with that car, the fellow in the gray suit.
Dr. Wickersham?
Yes.
I'd like your permission to leave here. I'm on my vacation, and I'd like to do a little hunting and fishing before I return to New York.
How long have you been here?
Just a few hours. Not long enough to contract any typhoid.
How do you know? You're not a doctor.
Yes, but I am.
Robert Ordway, M.D., Ph.D. Well, this is an unexpected pleasure, Doctor.
Thank you.
Shake hands with Dr. Prescott, the staff surgeon at our county clinic.
How do you do, Dr. Ordway?
Prescott, we're in luck. Perhaps we can draft Dr. Ordway into staying and helping us fight this epidemic.
He'd certainly be welcome.
Oh, please, gentlemen. Don't spoil my vacation. I haven't had one in years.
All kidding aside, Doctor, we're so short-handed at the clinic, Prescott's the only man I could bring, and these people need help desperately.
Well, my practice has been limited to psychiatry. I'm afraid I wouldn't be much help.
Now, Doctor, don't tell me you've forgotten how to use a microscope or make a subcutaneous vaccination.
Oh, no. All right, I'll stay and help.
Thanks very much. And we're making our headquarters here at the school. Suppose we meet you there in about an hour.
All right, I'll be there.
Doc Sam's going to be good and riled over outsiders putting into his business.
Now, won't that be too bad? Sam Millicent will do what he's told or else.
I reckon the town elders will have something to say about that.
In case you don't know it, Akers, you'll be taking orders from the state police until the quarantine's lifted.
Why are they putting the quarantine on the whole village?
Just showing off. I always said Doc Wickersham was too smart for his britches.
He's just mad because most of you folks won't go to his county clinic for doctoring.
I'll tell a man he is.
Well, ain't nobody going to poke medicine into folks of mine if they ain't sick. And if they try to, I'll take a horsewhip to them.
You're dang right, Squire. We got to show these outsiders they can't run things in Brook Falls. Hello, Ellen Minnish. Hurt, Mary?
No. Was you scared, Annie, when you got stuck with the needle?
Nah. Not much, you weren't. You're whiter than a sheep.
And you've been a ballin', Freddy Cat. I have not.
I'll leave her alone. Come on, Annie.
You're next, Zeke. Over to desk.
Howdy, Bill.
Your name, please?
Zeke Zill.
You were a brave little girl. Will you come in, please?
Come on, Abner.
Hi, Miss Edie.
Hi, Zeke.
Say, Judd, do you suppose vaccinating hurts you any?
No, it's just the idea that scares you a little.
Ma! Ma! I don't want to! Ma! Ma!
Now, don't be alarmed. If you become nauseated or your arms start to swell up, it'll just be the reaction to the vaccine. It won't last long.
Well, who ever heard of making folks sick to keep them well? Come on, Abner. We've gone home and tell your pa about this.
Next.
This is my woman, Edie, Mr. Ordway.
How do you do, Mrs. Rookstool?
Pleased to meet you.
Well, I'm glad to find that neither one of you are prejudiced against modern medicine.
Land's sakes, no. But I ain't let Doc Sam touch me. Not since our Liza died from his doctrine. Well, I told him so to his teeth, didn't I?
Which one of you shall I take first now?
You go ahead, Jed.
Roll up your sleeve, Jed, will you, please?
Is that highfalutin Wickersham in there?
Yeah, and bigger than all get out.
I'll take him down a peg or two.
Hello, Sam.
Don't hello me. You got a lot of gall of coming here scaring folks and trying to make a fool out of me.
Nobody's trying to make a fool out of you, but you'll make one out of yourself if you don't cooperate with the clinic when you've got a typhoid epidemic on your hands.
Typhoid, nothing. Just a regular run-of-summer complaint.
Look, Sam, I'm not going to argue with you. I've got my orders from the State Board of Health, and I intend to carry them out.
I suppose because you get the law on your side, you're thinking the folks are going to knuckle down to you, but I'm telling you they won't.
They will if you tell them to.
Me? You must be touched in the head. I'm a-telling them not to.
You'll obey the law or be put in jail.
All right, put me in jail and see what that gets you.
Well, Doctor, we've completed a survey of the village and collected some water and milk samples.
How many cases of typhoid did you find?
11 positive and 4 suspects. 2 deaths last night and 1 about a half an hour ago. Ward Beachy, the barber.
You hear that, Sam? 3 of your patients dead already.
It weren't my fault. They're dying. Some of your patients die too, don't they?
Yes, but not from homemade potions brewed by ignorant practitioners like you.
Now, look here.
I've been a doctoring man and beast round here for more than 30 years. Never had no complaints till you opened that clinic at the county seat.
I'm sorry, we've been over all that before, and I haven't got time to argue with you. You better plan on doing your postmortems tonight.
All right.
Found a place where you can do the work?
Yes, Hank Nixon's undertaking parlor in back of his drugstore.
Good.
Wickersham. Bear a minute, would you?
Discover something very peculiar here. Compare these three blood specimens and tell me what you think.
Bacillus typhosus, hosts of them.
Well, that's a specimen from deceased number one. This is from number two.
More bacillus typhosus.
Right. Now, take a careful look at specimen number three here.
Well, this specimen shows no typhoid bacilli at all.
Right.
Well, that means a third victim didn't die of typhoid.
But he did die, that we know. And from something that produced the same symptoms as typhoid.
Hmm. Who was the third victim?
The village barber, Ward Beachy.
Oh, yeah. Well, there's one report we won't have to send to the state laboratory.
Yeah, but I'm still puzzled by the symptoms he had. I ran into something similar a few years ago in a poison murder case.
Oh, look, Ordway. A typhoid epidemic is bad enough without dragging murder into it.
Oh, I'm not. I was just reminiscing.
Well, there's Prescott. Well, you got through in a hurry.
You flatter me. I was just starting when I found something very puzzling.
What's that?
Well, I wasn't surprised to find evidence of perforated peritonitis in the intestinal tract. But this is the first typhoid victim I've ever seen who had perforations extending through the whole alimentary canal.
Such as might have been caused by some corrosive poison?
Exactly.
Was it Beachy's body you examined?
Yes. How did you know?
Well, Ordway's been puzzled, too, because Beachy's blood specimen showed no typhoid bacilli.
I think you have a slight case of murder on your hands. It seems to me that a chemical analysis of the perforated tissue is in order. What do you think?
Well, sure. Well, let's get to work, Prescott.
All right.
Callahan.
Good morning.
Good morning, Dr. Wickersham. Prescott.
Well, good morning, Frau. How are you, Rumford?
Hey, doctor. So we've got a case of murder on our hands, huh?
Yeah. Oh, meet Dr. Ordway from New York. He's been helping us out with the vaccination problem here, and he is the one who discovered that Beachy didn't die of typhoid. This is Mort Crowell, our county prosecutor.
Got to know you, doctor.
And Harley Rumford, his investigator.
How do you do? Got any suspects?
One, Dr. Sam Millison.
Got a motive figured out that'll hold water?
I think it was revenge. Beachy quit him for the county clinic several months ago.
And Millicent's been fighting the clinic ever since it opened.
What do you think, Dr. Ordway?
Oh, I don't believe I'm entitled to an opinion. I've only been in Brook Falls such a short time.
If Beachy quit doctoring with Millicent, how could the latter have poisoned him?
Millicent was called in to treat him the day before he died.
Well, maybe it was just ignorance rather than criminal intent.
Oh, you don't know him like we do. He may be ignorant about doctoring, but he's cunning and vindictive.
Harley, it looks like your first job is to call at the Beachy home and get the medicines Dr. Millerson prescribed for the deceased.
Yes, sir.
Callahan, you get the suspect and bring him here for questioning.
Yes, sir.
What's the matter, Hank? You're all out of breath.
The prosecutor won't let me bury Ward.
How come they won't let you?
They're performing a post-mortem on him to find out what he died from.
You mean to say they ain't sure after telling us it wore typhoid fever?
I don't know, except I can't bury Ward Beachy till they say I can.
Oh, folly wrong. Why can't they let the dead rest in peace?
Is Doc Sam Millerson here?
I'm here.
I have orders to bring you over to the school for questioning.
Questioning? About what?
You'll find out when you get over there.
I'll be danged if I will. Nobody's gonna make a fool out of me twice. Your move, Squire.
I'm asking you to come peaceably, but if you won't, I'll take you.
You will you?
Now you keep out of this, Squire.
Reckon I know when you're exceeding your authority. You ain't a-touching Doc Sam unless you're arresting him for something. And if you are, he's got a right to know what for.
All right. Ward Beachy died of poison. And the county prosecutor thinks he was murdered.
Oh, fol-de-rol. Who'd want to kill a likable feller like Ward?
How'd you know he was poisoned?
Chemical tests don't lie.
Well, I hope the prosecutor don't think I poisoned him.
Well, you doctored him, didn't you?
Looks like them county clinic doctors are out to get me.
Yeah.
Oh, Squire, will you tell the sheriff to drive to the county seat and bring Link Hazen back here to defend me?
I sure will, Sam.
Oh, I reckon I'm ready now to go with you.
All right.
Now, why should I want to kill a lifelong friend and hurt his family? You were very angry, weren't you, when Beachy went to the county clinic for treatment? Yes, I was. And I told him so to his face. But being a Christian man, when Matilda come a-crying that Ward needed help, I did the best I could to take care of him.
You treated him and he died.
I've been a doctor and a lot of other folks, too, but none of them ever died of poison.
But the others didn't go to the county clinic.
In fairness to Millicent, I feel it my duty to advise him that he hasn't been charged with any crime, so he may refuse to answer any and all questions.
Why should you advise him? You're not his counsel.
I'm afraid you're letting prejudice bias your good judgment. We're not trying the man. We're only seeking information.
Hardway is right. In your opinion, when you examined Ward Beachy the other day, what was ailing him?
Summer complaint, and I still think it was.
So you gave him what?
Some of my complaint bitters.
Dr. Millerson, do you mind telling us what ingredients you used to compound your complaint bitters?
Not at all. First, I boiled some sassafras bark, and some bloodroot, and some burdock leaves, and some golden seal, and then I add a little pulverized bone and a little oil of wintergreen to give it a good taste.
Did he mention anything there that sounded like a poison to you, Wickerson?
Well, I'm not an herbalist, but I'll concede the formula's perfectly harmless. However, that is no proof that he didn't poison Beachy.
I didn't, so help me, I didn't.
That's all. Millerson, you may go now.
Aren't you going to arrest him?
Not without some justification.
You're making a big mistake.
I'm not telling you how to run the county clinic, am I?
Thank you, sir.
I'm sorry I popped off, Wickerson.
It's all right, Mort. Forget it. I had it coming.
Well, I guess there isn't much we can do now till Rumford gets back. So we might as well enjoy a short recess.
Right.
Certainly a beautiful day.
I should be out doing a little fishing, too.
Oh, now, Doctor, don't run out on us now. We're only halfway through.
That's right. Here's the bottle of bitters that Beachy was taking before he died. According to Mrs. Beachy, he took about 10 spoonsful.
Phew, what awful stuff. Send this to the state clinical laboratory for analysis.
Yes, sir.
Say, I'd like to offer a suggestion if it's in order.
Go ahead.
Oh, it's so obvious it's probably slipped your mind, but why not let Rumford find out if Nixon sold any corrosive poison lately? If so, to whom?
Why, of course. Who else could have been the source of the poison? Why didn't you think of it, Rumford?
Why didn't you?
According to the druggist, he sold 1 pound of that poison to Doc Millicent and 5 pounds to Ezra Minich, the nurseryman.
Well, what did Millicent tell you he did with the pound he bought?
He claims he used it to make up an ointment for boils and carbuncles.
Ah, a whole pound of that would make up enough ointment for all the boils and carbuncles in the United States.
He only used about 3 ounces.
What did Millicent do with the rest of it?
He still has it.
Well, I presume the nurseryman used the poison in some sort of a plant spray.
Yes, and in a rat poison which he manufactures.
Well, then, that makes every person who has bought his plant spray and rat poison a possible suspect.
Look, Ordway, you seem to be trying awfully hard to remove suspicion from Millicent.
What was that? Somebody shot at me.
Yeah, I'm afraid they did.
Good thing for you, Doc. If that bullet had been a couple inches lower, it'd taken most of your head off.
There's a bullet hole in the window over there. It should have lodged back here somewhere. Well, here it is.
Well, why would anybody want to shoot at me?
Well, that's what we've got to find out.
Whoever it was didn't hang around after he fired the shot, but he left his calling card.
Oh, that's a 30-30 shell, the same as I use in my rifle.
Dr. Ordway, did you bring a 30-30 rifle with you?
Yes, yes.
And he lives at Doc Millerson's.
Don't you think we ought to have a look at it?
Why, yes, by all means. I'm just as curious as you are. Come on. Hello.
If you came to see the doctor, he ain't home. Martha McVitie sprained her knee. He's over tending to it.
No, we didn't come to see him, Mrs. Millicent. This way, gentlemen. Uh-oh, that's funny.
What's funny?
Why, I can tell by the weight that my rifle's not in the case.
When did you last see it?
Yesterday. I was showing it to Judd Rookstool. What are you laughing at?
Does Judd have access to your room when you're not here?
Why, no, not that I know of.
Well, do you need any more convincing that your host is the logical suspect?
Oh, it'll take more than that.
Well, why don't you confront Millicent and see what he has to say for himself?
A good idea. Coming along, Ordway?
Certainly, I wouldn't miss this for anything.
There he is.
Well, hello, Hazen.
Hello, Crow.
Millicent, we've been checking up on you.
On me? What for?
How long have you been here?
Oh, 5 minutes, maybe.
What are you getting at, Crow?
According to Mrs. McVitie, he arrived at her place about 7:05 and left about 5:30. It's now 8:25. You mean to tell me it took you 50 minutes to get from McVitie's here?
Certainly not. Any fool would know better than that.
What were you doing in the meantime?
Appears to me that what I do with my own time's my own business.
You'll give me a civil answer, or I'll put you under arrest.
Oh, just a minute, Mr. Prosecutor. Now, it's all right with me if you want to arrest him. But if you do, I'm going to have to ask the squire here to hold an immediate hearing so I can have him released on bail. That is, unless you're figuring on charging him with some ridiculous offense like murder, which you can't prove.
Just say the word, Link, and I'll give you a hearing right here and now.
Well, I'm not ready yet to file a murder charge against anybody.
No, I didn't think you was. Go ahead with your checker plan, Sam.
Well, I think I'll call it a night and get some sleep. Good night, boys.
Good night. Good night.
I was just turning back the covers of your bed.
Thanks. I'm pretty tired tonight.
It might be nice of you to stand up for Pa and them county doctors. We both admire you for it.
Well, nobody should be accused of murder unless it can be proven.
No. Pa wouldn't do such a thing. He's too tender-hearted to kill a fly.
Mrs. Millison, you've lived in Brook Falls a good many years. Who do you think could have poisoned Beachy?
I'd rather not speak my mind. Then I wouldn't be hurting anybody.
Maybe so. You just forget that I asked you. Have you been in the house all evening?
Supping for a spell while I was out milking. Why?
My rifle wasn't in this case when I looked about an hour ago. Now it's back. It's been fired.
Lieutenant.
Hello, Littleton. One of these days, those brakes of yours are not going to work.
Then the Trayville Gazette will lose its star reporter.
Not so fast, pal. I'll have to announce you to the prosecutor.
Ha, ha, ha.
The press has arrived, I see.
Hiya, Chief. I understand you're investigating a nice little murder.
Yes, that's right.
Well, how about giving me a break? Who did it to who?
Ward Beachy, the town barber, came to his death from poison at the hands of a person or persons unknown.
Is that all you can give me?
I'm sorry, but that's all I know.
Why, Dr. Ordway, what are you doing in this outpost of civilization? I'm Littleton, formerly with the Times Tribune, remember? I covered that famous case you solved, the paper doll murders.
Oh, yes. Do you mean to tell me he's a detective, too?
Wait, now, don't hold that against me, please.
Well, no wonder your suggestions have proven so helpful. I hate to ask you to give up any more of your vacation, but I certainly would appreciate it if you'd see this thing through with me.
Wait a minute. Now, you've already got a competent man on the job.
Oh, thanks for them kind words, but I'd much rather you take over. This thing's too deep for me.
What do you say?
Go ahead. You wouldn't deny me the greatest news story I've had in years.
All right, Crawl. Tell you what, I'll start by interviewing the family of the deceased. I believe if you can get enough people to talk enough, you're bound to stir up something. Sit down, please. Now, don't be upset, Mrs. Beachy, because if you're frightened, you won't understand what I'm talking about.
But I didn't poison Ward. I loved him. I did.
Nobody said you poisoned him. How long were you and Ward married?
18 years. Mostly.
Mostly?
We used to split up once or twice a year over his romancing, but 'twarn't his fault. He was the handsomest man in Brook Falls. Why, even my own sister Belle got fluttery and slow-eyed when he was around.
Can you think of anyone who might have hated him enough to have poisoned him?
No, I can't.
Well, thanks for your cooperation, Mrs. Beachy. What else do you know?
All I know, he's dead. And I ain't a grieving none, because he's a low-down, mean a ma.
Did you kill your father, Jonas?
No, so help me. I couldn't kill my own flesh and blood.
I know you couldn't have, son. You may go now.
Thanks.
Come in.
Why are you looking at me like that?
You're a very attractive girl, Miss Englehart. I can readily understand why your deceased brother-in-law was attracted by you.
Well, I guess he was kind of taken with me, because he was all the time trying to spoon when Matilda weren't around. But you mustn't rest Clem. He didn't poison Ward.
Who's Clem?
He's my beau, Clem is. Works for Noe Plank at the blacksmith shop.
Oh, I see. Did Clem know that Ward was infatuated with you?
Well, I told him because I wanted to get him a little jealous. But Clem wouldn't kill anyone over a little harmless flirting.
Who did kill him, Belle?
I haven't got the slightest idea. Cross my heart.
All right. Thanks for the information anyway.
You mean you're all through talking to me?
Well, for now, yes.
Morning, Clem. I'd like you to meet Dr. Ordway, who's helping me investigate the murder.
Glad to meet you.
Hi, Clem.
Was Ward really poisoned?
Yes, he was. I understand you're kind of sweet on Belle Englehart.
Oh, you're dang right I am. I'm aiming to marry her come next June.
Well, then it's no wonder you were mad when Beachy wanted to make up to her.
I'll tell him, man. I was fixing to swing at him. But I got afeard the folks might get to gossiping about Belle. But somebody else did swing at him as he come to his shop one morning with a black eye.
Do you know who gave it to him?
I'd rather not say.
We don't care what you'd rather do. It's against the law to withhold any information, so start talking.
Well, one night Belle and me was to the picnic grounds. We seen Ward and Edie Rookstool holding hands. Then pretty soon we seen Judd watching him.
And?
The next morning, Ward showed up with a black eye.
Yeah.
Well, you've been very helpful, Clem. Thank you very much. We appreciate it.
Good morning, Clem. Dr. Ordway, do you think Judd killed Beachy?
Well, he's a likely suspect, but so is everyone else I've talked to so far.
Who's next?
The man who makes that plant spray and rat poison.
Morning, Ezra.
Morning.
Morning.
Dr. Ordway would like to ask you some questions about the poison you use in making your plant spray and rat killer.
What you want to know?
I'd like to see the book you keep for signatures of everyone who buys these poison mixtures from you.
I ain't got no such book.
Didn't you have to sign your name when you bought the poison at Nixon's drugstore?
No. Hank said he'd do it for me because I can't read nor write.
Well, didn't the druggist tell you that it was against the law to resell the poison without getting the buyers to sign for it?
No. Is it again the law?
Certainly. You can be put in jail for what you've been doing.
I'll get me a book right smart. You know, I thought first you'd come to ask me about the shooting at the schoolhouse.
What do you know about it?
Well, I was a-planting some cuttings by lantern light when I heard a shot. So I blowed out the light and slipped back in the shadows. By and by, a man come a-running by. carrying a gun. It was Doc Sam Millerson.
You don't like Millerson, do you?
No. Look what he done to my boy.
B.G. playing horsey.
What did he do?
He brought him into the world of dunce, can't you see?
Get up, horsey.
Well, much obliged, Mr. Minich.
Glad to help you.
Horsey.
You think he actually saw Millerson as he claims?
Oh, I don't know. It's hard to believe a man when he's nursing such a deep grudge against another. It's too bad, though, that he should blame Millerson for what was probably a biological failure on the part of nature.
Yeah, if it were a biological failure. Well, who's next on the list?
Judd Rookstuhl. I'm going to try a little experiment on him tonight.
I'm going to ask you some questions, Judd. You're going to answer them truthfully.
Yes, ma'am.
When did you first suspect that your wife, Edie, and Ward Beachy were on such friendly terms?
Last year, at the summer festival, when I watched them dancing together.
What did you do about it?
I pretended I was going fishing. Then I sneaked back to see what went on.
Did you see anything that looked suspicious?
I sure did. I seen my woman leaving the picnic grounds. I was hiding behind the bandstand, and I watched her slip through the woods toward the creek. I was right on her heels as she sashayed toward the swimming hole.
To see you, Edie, honey.
Oh, you're just a feeding me traffic.
No, I ain't. Cross my heart. I'd rather see you than anybody in the whole world.
Oh, Ward, you say such pretty words.
I gotta say pretty words to the prettiest woman in the county. I'm stuck on you, honey.
Go on home where you belong, Edie. I'll tend to you when I get there.
Yes, Judd.
I reckon I did you wrong, Judd.
Why don't you get up and fight me, you low-down skunk?
I can't fight you when I'm to blame.
All right. I'll let you go for now. But I'm warning you. You keep away from Edie or I'll kill you. And I weren't fooling when I told him that.
And did he keep away from her?
He sure did.
Did you give Ward a drink of moonshine with some poison in it?
No, ma'am, so help me.
No, I know you didn't, Judd. I was only fooling. Come on, wake up. Wake up, Judd. You can't sleep here all night.
What happened? To fall asleep?
You slept so soundly you didn't even hear these men come in.
Well, I'll be a son of a gun. Say, what was it you told me you wanted me to do? I plumb forgot.
You're going to Trayville tomorrow to do some shopping for me. Remember?
That's right. Sure, now I remember. Well, I'd better be catching some more sleep if I'm going to get an early start.
Yeah, that's right, Judd. I'll see you tomorrow.
Now you know why they call him the crime doctor.
Oh, I'm afraid you gentlemen are overestimating my accomplishments. I regret to say my experiment was a failure.
What do you mean a failure?
Did you notice the emotional expression on Judd's face while he was answering my questions?
Sure.
Yeah, sure.
The person speaking while in a state of hypnosis merely articulates words from his subconscious mind. Therefore, having no consciousness, there can be no expression of emotion.
You mean Judd wasn't hypnotized?
That's right. You can't hypnotize a person against his will, and Judd was too strong-willed. I sensed that the minute I started. He told us that cock and bull story just to take suspicion off himself, or probably to shield somebody else, maybe his wife, Edie.
Well, the deeper we get into this affair, the more muddled it becomes.
It looks that way. When you stir up dirty water, you've got to wait for it to settle. Well, gentlemen, shall we adjourn?
Yes, might as well. Good morning.
Won't you come in and set a spell?
Thank you. I sent Judd to Trayville this morning so I can have a little talk with you.
I've been expecting you sooner. I was wondering when you could take the hint. You want to sit down?
Mrs. Rookstall, I'm afraid you misunderstand. I'm here on official business, investigating the death of Ward Beachy.
Well, why should you ask me? I don't know nothing about his dying.
You were kind of sweet on him, weren't you?
Who told you that? Ellie Minich?
Oh, I'd rather not say.
Well, if Ellie did, it's because he shook her and came a-running after me. But I didn't encourage him. I got a man of my own.
You were the cause of him getting a black eye, weren't you?
Did Ellie say that? Why, that old hussy, I ought to snatch her bald-headed.
You didn't answer my question.
Ward didn't get no black eye on my account. And if she says so, she's a big liar. And what's more, she was so jealous of him that I wouldn't have put it past her to do the poisoning.
Well, I wonder if she'll speak as well of you, but... Well, thanks very much, Mrs. Rookstall. Good morning.
Good morning. That Ellie Minich.
Hello, darling. Is your mother in?
Yes, sir. Mommy! Mommy, there's a gentleman here to see you.
All right, Myri.
Oh, what a nice doll.
That's Ellie Mae. She's getting pretty old. She's almost three, you know.
Yes.
If you want to ask me about Ward Beachy, I don't know nothing. Except there's talk that he was poisoned.
I understand he was kind of sweet on you until he started running after Edie Rookstall.
That's a big lie. Who told you that, Edie?
You used to meet him on the sly, didn't you?
No. No, he was nothing to me.
The poison was easy for you to get. Your husband kept it in the nursery.
I don't care if he did. I never touched it. But Edie, she bought some to kill rats, so she said. Why don't you ask her about it?
Well, I think I will. At least I'll be able to find out which one of you is telling the truth. Good day, Mrs. Minich.
Edie Rookstall, huh? So she's been running me down. Well, I'll show her a thing or two.
Does that mean we can leave town if we're a minder?
Yeah, you can go anywhere you like now.
Hooray!
Mr. Ordway.
Thank you.
Quarantine's over, folks. They're tearing down the signs.
You say the quarantine's no more?
Yeah, that's what he said.
Then I'll have to get out the advertising for the summer festival.
Yeah.
I was getting afeard we'd have to postpone the festival on account of the quarantine, but now we won't have to.
Well, sounds interesting.
It sure does.
Folks got something to celebrate this year.
You bet they have.
Looks like we're going to have fine weather for it, Jeremiah.
You've been a-talking about me behind my back, huh?
No more than you've been a-talking about me, Ellie Minich.
You're a jealous little hussy, that's what you are.
You're another.
Come out here, fellas, if you want to see a couple of shemales a-fighting.
What are you? You ought to be ashamed of yourselves. Go on home. Go on home, and I'll come out of you. Ever see anything like that?
Well, I wonder what started that brawl.
The pot calling the kettle black, I reckon.
Oh, my. Say, Sheriff, by the way, do they ever have any target shooting contests at these festivals?
Well, not that I know of. Why?
Well, I should think such a contest would be popular. I'd like to donate the prizes.
That sure sounds like a good idea. I'd like to enter that contest myself.
Me too.
Yeah, look, will you make the arrangements then?
Sure will.
All right, there'll be three prizes for the men and three for the women. $25, $15, and
$10. What? $25. Jumping Jupiter. For $25, you'll have everybody in town shooting their head off.
Yeah. Well,
that's the general idea. The more, the merrier.
Mighty generous of you, Doctor.
I'm very happy to do it.
He's all right. There you are, sir. Decision. The first prize for the men goes to Judd Rookstool with four bullseyes. And the second prize to Doc Sam Millerson with three bullseyes. And the third prize to Clem Ogle. Now the contest for the ladies was the prettiest tie you ever see. Between Edie Rookstool and Ellie Minich. So, Dr. Ordway is awarding two first prizes instead of one. The second prize goes to Emmy Millerson. And the third prize to Miss Belle Engelhart. if you win, come up here. I'll give you the money.
Hey, Luke, did you win the shooting prize?
Nah. I couldn't hit the broad side of a barn. Yeah. Much obliged, Nellie.
You're welcome.
Wait here while I go see who it is.
It's Doc Sam, and he's been shot. Go get the sheriff.
Thought I recognize your voice, Clem. Did you say Doc Sam's been shot?
Yeah. Fellow and me heard the gun, and we found him laying here.
I thought I heard a shot, too.
Something terrible's happened.
What?
Somebody just shot Doc Millicent down by the swimming hole.
What?
What?
Somebody's got to tell Emmy.
Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute, I will, but not right now. No use telling anyone else until we know more about it. Freddy's dead. If you don't want to get put in jail, meet me down by the swimming hole when it gets dark.
I can't figure why anybody want to kill poor old Doc. Danged if I can.
Well, it's quite obvious. He knew something that was dangerous to somebody. Probably the person who murdered Ward.
Yeah, but how did he...
Luigi. Come here, boy. Where did you get that gun? Give it here.
I don't know.
Wait a minute, Sheriff. Let me handle this, will you? Well, BG, now you look like a real soldier.
Real soldier, BG. Real gun.
Will you let me see nice gun? Been fired recently.
Their initials on here, S.M. Doc Sam.
Well, I thought you locked up all the rifles for safekeeping, Sheriff.
I did. Doc Sam's was among them. I took it from him myself.
Well, that's irony for you. Millerson gets killed by his own gun.
B.G., where did you find gun?
Bushes. Throw it away there.
Did you see who threw it away? Who?
He's a liar, is what he is.
Maybe he is and maybe he ain't.
Why should I want to shoot Doc Sam? You can't believe what a dunce says.
Maybe Beezy's a lot smarter than any of us calculate. What was you doing alongside the riverbank?
I was down here looking for Edie.
Yeah? Expect to find her in swimming?
No, but I found her down here before.
Jed Rookstool, I'm arresting you for the murder of Doc Sam.
But I didn't, Luke, so help me. You don't believe I killed him, do you, Mr. Ordway?
Don't make no difference what anybody thinks. Come along.
Maybe you'd better go, Judd. He won't be able to hold you long.
I'm not so sure of that. Get going, Judd.
You must have a good reason for believing Judd innocent. Yes, I have. I'll tell you more about it in the morning.
Now go to sleep, Ellie Mae. Go to sleep. Be a good girl now. My mommy ain't home.
Oh, I came to see you.
Oh, come in.
While I was over at Trayville this morning, I bought you a little present. This is sort of an addition to your doll family and a sister to Ella Mae.
Thank you. She's beautiful.
Isn't she pretty?
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome. Look, Myra, did you ever see this piece of paper before?
I sure have. I wrote it myself.
You did?
Yes. It's just some writing practice my pa got me to do, so I'd get to be a first-rate writer in school. And I can read, too. If you don't want to get put in jail, meet me down by the swimming hole when it gets dark.
Is your father home?
I reckon he's out back somewheres.
I think I'll see him before I go.
Okay. Thank you again for the beautiful doll.
Morning, Ezra.
Howdy. It's a pretty hot day, ain't it?
Yes, sure is.
Let me pour you a drink of cool cider.
Well, that'll be fine.
Nothing like cider on a hot day.
That's right.
Well, here's looking at you.
Gee, that smells good, you know it?
I'll tell a man it's good.
Yeah. I'd like to buy that whole jug for
him. Nope, it ain't for sale.
Why not?
It ain't for sale.
Why? Did you put the same poison in it as you did the corn whiskey you sold Beachy? I wasn't sure of that until Myra just confirmed my suspicion that you'd shot Doc Millicent.
You think you're pretty smart, don't you? Getting a little child to give a paw away.
No, there's nothing smart about it. It was the obvious thing for you to do since you can't read or write. You killed Beachy because he was trying to break up your home, didn't you?
Yeah, but you ain't gonna get no chance to prove it again me. Because I ain't letting you. Thank you.
What's the matter? Nobody's going to hurt you. What's you crying for?
Vaughn, Mr. Ordway, you're fighting.
Fight! Eddie, you take care of her. Come on, pal.
Arrest him for the murders of Ward Beachy and Doc Millerson.
You mean to say that Esri here poisoned Ward?
Yes, he put poison in the corn whiskey he sold Beachy, and he tried to kill me the same way, too. The cider in that jug in the Lath House is poisoned.
Why, you dang fool! You might have killed Ward's whole family. I'm locking you up. Come on.
Don't forget to release Judd Rookstool. He's as innocent as killing Doc Millerson as you are.
Yes, sir.
You sure you're all right, Dr. Ordway?
Oh, I guess so. Thanks.
Mighty glad of that.
Why, of course he's touched in the head. Nobody in his right mind would carry on like that.
I want to thank you again, Mr. Ordway, for getting me out of jail. That sheriff sure had me scared to pieces.
Well, I was glad to be able to do you a good turn, Judd.
I heard why Esri poisoned Ward, but I can't for the life of me figure out why he shot Sam.
Well, when he was planning to murder Beachy, he asked Doc Millerson how much plant spray it would take to kill a man. And then after the crime, he got afraid that Doc would remember and tell the sheriff. Well, goodbye, Judd.
Goodbye. It's a dang shame it spoils your vacation. You didn't get a chance to do any shooting.
Well, maybe I'll come back next year. That is, if you promise not to have any more murders.
Crowell wants you to come right over to the jail. Ezra Minich is acting crazier than the loon.
What do they expect me to do? Give him a sedative?
They don't know what to do with him. Crowell wants to put him in the county jail. The sheriff wants to put him in a nut house.
All right, I'll drive right over.
I'll meet you there.
Having some trouble, huh?
Yeah.
The way he's been acting?
Yeah, frankly, I'm stumped. If he's actually deranged, it'd be a miscarriage of justice to prosecute him.
Well, feigned insanity is quite easy to prove. I know a very simple test. Get me an old newspaper, will you?
Yes, sir. Yeah. You can use the Trayville Gazette.
Fine, now, bring him out, will you?
Yes, sir.
All I have to do is place some paper in his hand and set fire to it. If he's actually insane, he'll hold onto the paper even though the fire burns his hand.
I didn't know
that. Oh, yes, yes. A sane person will drop the paper the minute he gets burned.
Come on, Esri.
No, he's as sane as any of us. The game's up, Minich. You just trapped yourself, as I expected you would. You heard what I said about the test, so you held on to the burning paper because you reasoned that that would save your neck. Well, an insane person does not reason, and he would have dropped the paper at the first sensation of pain.
I'll get you for that!
Have his burned his treated, then take him to Trayville and put him in the county jail. You're taking a load off of my mind, Dr. Ordway. And I want to thank you for all the help you've given me.
It's all right.
Yeah, me too, Dr. Ordway. I've learned a whole lot working with you, and If there's anything I can do to show my appreciation, just say so.
Oh, well, yes. Yeah, there is something you can do for me.
Name it.
I'd like to have that set of antlers over there.
Well, you can have it, but what for?
Well, if you remember, I really came here to hunt and fish. Now, if I get back home without even as much as a set of antlers, I'll never hear the last of it. What do you say?
She's yours.
Dr. Ordway, yeah. I know where I can get you a half a dozen more.